Okay, the final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 12371 in the name of Sandy Scoulhanny on International Long COVID Awareness Day 2024. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Dr. Scoulhanny to open the debate around 7 minutes.
Thank you. I wish to draw members' attention to my register of interest as a practising NHS GP, and I'd like to thank all members of the cross-party group on long COVID for their much valued work over the past 2.5 years, especially my co-conveners Alex Cole-Hamilton and Jackie Bailey. On the 1st of March 2020, Scotland confirmed its first case of COVID-19. I wish to pay my respects to the friends and families of over 17,600 Scots who died after contracting this horrible virus. Today, to commemorate International Long COVID Day, we're focused on addressing the Scottish Government's failure to adequately support over 187,000 Scots who survived COVID but are yet to fully recover. 187,000 Scots, of whom 10,000 are children. Patients and their families, some have come and joined us today in the gallery. And they have come here, and it will be a sacrifice for the rest of the week because they have used all their energy up this week to come and protest and support. But they don't want to hear platitudes. I hosted a drop-in session in Parliament earlier this afternoon for Long COVID Scotland, and the patients and families told us they were weary. They're tired of having to fight for help. A lot were angry. They feel their pleas fell on deaf ears. They spent 3 years being fobbed off. They've heard the announcements, promises of cash, but they continue to suffer physical and emotional pain and distress and struggle to access specialist support and rehabilitation services. Many are economically devastated by the condition, including nurses and paramedics, some of whom I met today, infected at work, now unable to work. In our long COVID debate in March last year, we highlighted a lack of consistency with the SNP government's approach to supporting long COVID patients. Their approach is piecemeal. It's not streamlined, and patients are truly feeling abandoned by this government, by the resulting uncoordination and inconsistent care with no national approach. And as for children, the charity Long COVID Kids tells us, there are still no spaces for young people, no single point of contact, as promised. And we understand from Chest Heart Stroke Scotland that 82% of long COVID sufferers encountered difficulty accessing services, 43% not referred to rehab services, a lack of overall information on self-management of their condition. 71% of long COVID patients surveyed said their mental health deteriorated. 40% said long COVID's affected their ability to work and earn a living. And we know that many struggle to access social security payments. For those fortunate enough not to be impacted by long COVID, let me briefly describe some of the symptoms that patients are living with. Severe fatigue, dizziness, brain fog, pain in their joints, poor mental health, slurred speech, indescribable headaches, fluctuating heart rates, numbness, gastrointestinal issues. Long COVID is a very complex condition, and that's why our response must be shaped by best clinical practice, not managers, nor bean counters. Continuing to pass patients like batons between services and departments with no one taking responsibility won't wash for our visitors in the gallery. They've had enough. I'm particularly upset about the Scottish Government's poor response, because we could see the problem unfolding and shared solutions. Long COVID was the focus of my maiden speech in Parliament on May the 27th, 2021. By June, I'd authored a long COVID paper, a proposed action plan to invest in a network of specialist clinics, which include virtual clinics and app-based treatment services, ring-fence funding for long COVID care and research. We wanted to get the very best from across the UK and bring it here. We needed a clear rehab pathway, including an MDT with GPs and physios and OTs. On the 9th September 21, Health Secretary at the time, Humza Yousaf, announced £10 million for long COVID. And FOI has shown that instead of being over 3 years, this has now gone over 4 years. Almost a year after this, in March 14th, 23, and you'll recall the political landscape had shifted, Health Secretary Humza Yousaf was now First Minister, and then 175,000 Scots were struggling with long COVID. And we were informed that this funding had provided £20,000 for public health intelligence gathering in the Western Isles, £120,000 for self-management resources and peer support in the Highlands, £178,000 to develop a long COVID rehab pathway in Fife. But we have seen that a total of just £1.1 million has been spent by health boards and organisations from the fund during 2022-23. And this included awards of £144,000 to COVID Aid, an online support group that was closed down a year later. Only NHS Lanarkshire received more long COVID money for treating patients in 22 than this website. Meanwhile, during the financial year 23-24, over £2.7 million had been allocated, including £600,000 to NHS Glasgow and Clyde, £370,000 to NHS Lothian. But what matters is not the money, but the action and outcomes, because patients are not spreadsheets. And from what we heard today, patients do not feel as though they are getting access to rehab. They are getting access to the treatments and the people that they think and believe and actually deserve to get. We know long COVID is complex. We know that research is ongoing. But for me, the most important thing we can do is listen to people who have long COVID, who are suffering, who are struggling, and try to involve them, try to get them into our treatment centres and give them the support that they deserve. Thank you. And I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Dr. Bilhani. We now move to the open debate. I call first Bill Kidd, to be followed by Jackie Bailey, up to 4 minutes. Mr. Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to start by thanking our colleague Sandesh Gulhani for bringing today's debate to the Chamber. I do have to apologise for not having been to meet people earlier today, as I was out of the Parliament on a long established visit to a university I had to speak to. However, I have listened to what has been said. This is an important issue because, as the motion states, it's estimated 187,000 people have long COVID in Scotland, and 10,000 of whom are children. And I agree with the member's point that there is not enough awareness of the debilitating effects of long COVID and the huge number of people suffering from its effects. In this vein, I hope that International Day of Long COVID Awareness, as well indeed as today's debate, will both help to better inform people in general and provide focus for those investigating and seeking to develop treatments for this illness. On the levels of government involvement, I believe that when attempting to evaluate any progress or when levelling any perceived criticisms, it's essential to recognise that long COVID was born out of an unprecedented global pandemic and was discovered only in the last couple of years, although obviously I'll leave the Minister to talk about how it's being addressed by government. I don't say this to distract from the seriousness of the issue we are debating today or the suffering of so many with long COVID, but simply in the hope that when we debate this issue, we also give recognition to the fact that, as with any new diagnosis, it will take some time, possibly, to develop treatments for it and to deliver that treatment, that we need to do it as soon as we can. And I agree that here in Scotland, we need to do everything we can to understand and treat long COVID, but I feel we also have to make more of an effort to look at this issue as a continuation of the pandemic, and it's an issue that needs a coordinated response. When COVID-19 struck and the world reeled from its effects, we also came together to identify, understand and develop a vaccine against the virus, and then to roll out vaccines programmes across on a global level. And we need to approach long COVID in the same way, for while here in Scotland we know that over 180,000 people are estimated to suffer from this disease and illness, globally this figure is over 65 million by conservative issues. It's probably a great deal more. Clearly, this is a global issue and needs a global response, and I hope Scotland can be at the heart of this. The 2023 Demystifying Long COVID International Conference took place in December in Madrid, and would Scotland and would the Scottish Government or indeed our Parliament consider staging such an event to bring together experts here and indeed globally to understand better and work together in the development of effective treatments? Scottish universities have a global reputation for excellence, and the work that they do with medical science companies is second to none, putting Scotland at the heart of global efforts to research and develop effective treatments for long COVID would have numerous benefits, helping those suffering first and foremost. It would also benefit our education and pharma sectors by attracting global funding and ultimately helping to fund a number of the actions being called for in today's motion. So I want to see Scotland take a lead in research and development, and to make this happen, I'd be keen to hear from the Minister on the obvious and potential benefits of placing Scotland front and centre. Every day we learn more. Only today it was reported that studies showed that active COVID antigens were found in the blood of long COVID sufferers up to 14 months after infection, and for more than 2 years in tissue samples, potentially revolutionising how we treat this disgusting disease. Let's put Scotland at the centre of the revolution, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr Kidd. I now call on Jackie Bailey to be followed by Brian Whittle. Around 4 minutes, Ms Bailey.
Thank you. Let me join with others on congratulating Sandis Gulhani for securing this debate and for the considered view he offered to the Chamber. Can I also say to Bill Kidd, there isn't very much that I would disagree with in terms of his contribution as well. But let me also thank Long COVID Scotland and Long COVID Kids Scotland for the work that they do all year round to advocate on behalf of those living with long COVID, and I acknowledge them in the gallery this afternoon. This, of course, is the third time we've debated long COVID in the Scottish Parliament, and it is a matter of considerable regret that very little has changed since the first time we did so, other than we are now on to our third Cabinet Secretary. There's been no new funding, no new research or treatments offered, and the Scottish Government has even stopped gathering regular and frequent data on how many people are affected. Disappointingly, it's never been interested in gathering data on prevalence amongst children. The result of this is that we are effectively in the dark about how many people are truly living with long COVID, with estimates in the region of 187,000 adults. Whilst we might not know exact numbers, what we do know is that each reinfection of COVID-19 increases the chance of long COVID, and around 1 in 10 COVID infections lead to long-term symptoms. So no one is immune to this risk, and yet vaccination, which is acknowledged as the best form of protection, is now restricted to those over 75 and people who are immunosuppressed. Long COVID isn't something that will just go away, or that the government can pretend that it isn't a big deal, as it appears to do with similar illnesses like ME and CFS. The truth is that due to the paltry level of support from the Scottish Government, the NHS is failing to adequately support Scotland's long COVID population. A report published by Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland last week, referenced by Sandis Gulhani, found that 72% of people with long COVID said there was support they needed but weren't able to access. 82% encountered some kind of difficulty in accessing services, with some struggling to access any medical support. And 38% said their doctor wasn't able to provide guidance on available support. That's not good enough. The Long COVID Support Fund, which was £10 million over 3 years, is now entering its final year, although I hear it may be stretched over four. Perhaps the Minister could clarify that. But single-year funding has led to underspends and difficulty in recruiting staff. Any board wanting to run a specific long COVID clinic has been told no. And frankly, £12.88 per person is simply not enough. What has happened to the £27 million in Barnett consequentials for long COVID, which is estimated to have come from the UK government? Properly funding long COVID treatment is not just a medical necessity, it's an economic one. And a report written by the European Commission in January this year found that long COVID symptoms hugely affect the capacity to participate in the labour market. Chest, Heart and Stroke survey confirms this, indicating that 40% of people living with long COVID are unable to work at all due to their condition, which equates to as many as 72,000 Scots exiting the labour market since 2020. Put simply, the SNP government is failing those with long COVID, and warm words, frankly, won't cut it anymore. The Scottish Government must take this crisis in hand, properly fund long COVID services, ensure accurate data collection, and implement the recommendations from the COVID-19 Committee's long COVID report as a matter of urgency. Must also commit to improving public health messaging on long COVID, fund new co-produced research with lived experience at its heart, and ensure that there is equitable access to co-produced health and social care services with the specialist multidisciplinary teams that are required. It is time to properly treat and fund long COVID once and for all, and I sincerely hope that the Minister and the Cabinet Secretary are listening, because long COVID sufferers will not go away quietly, no matter how much the government may want them to, and frankly, they can't wait any longer, so please act.
Thank you. I now call Brian Whittle to be followed by Beatrice Wishart, around 4 minutes, Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank my friend and colleague, Sandis Gulhani, for bringing this debate to the Chamber. I think, looking back at my time on the COVID Recovery Committee, when we did an investigation into long COVID, and listening to some of the sufferers we spoke with out the front of the Parliament, I think it's disquieting to hear some of the same things being said these years later, and the fact that we don't seem to have made any progress at all. And one of the things that really struck me was that many of those who are suffering from long COVID are the essential workers for which we relied on during COVID. And these are people like our healthcare workers, our teachers, and our police. Many of those who are unable to work now, and actually many of them are losing jobs. And when 187,000 people now estimated to be suffering from long COVID, given the debate we just came out of before around the economically inactive and how we want to move on our economy, surely that in itself is a reason why we should be taking long COVID a lot more seriously than we currently do. Because it seems to me at the time, I'm going back now, I don't know how long it was, 3 years ago when we had the long COVID inquiry, one of the things that was said then is that it was a condition that wasn't being recognised with the health profession. It was a condition where they didn't know where to go to, they didn't know where to seek advice. There was only one long COVID nurse in the whole of Scotland. And then here we are again, all these years later, and this time later, hearing the very same thing. So we haven't moved on. It is disappointing. We need specialist treatment. We need to gather the data, and not just data within Scotland. We need to understand the research and the global data. Again, these are calls that came from the Long COVID Committee report 2-3 years ago, whenever that happened to be. These are the same things we were saying 2 or 3 years ago. Now, I recognise, of course, Deputy Presiding Officer, that the healthcare system is under stress. We recognise that. But I think, you know, with 187,000 sufferers, and I have to confess, having had long COVID myself on a much, much smaller level than some of the people we spoke to today, and it still affects me now, it still affects my system. So if you are, and I say I don't in any way, shape or form, say I have the same issues as the people who we met today, but if that's affecting me 2-3 years later, still affecting me every now and again, I can only imagine what it was like and what it is like for those who have got this condition seriously. And some of the things they talk about, you know, joint pain, chest pain, abdominal pain, fog, you know, unable to think straight, and headaches. And it comes back and it revisits these people so often. So we need to take it much more seriously than we currently do. We need a pathway. We need a pathway for diagnosis, and we need a pathway for treatment. As I understand, there was £10 million put into long COVID, but that was over 4 years. That £2.5 million a year is not going to, it's not going to scratch the surface of this. So we need to start looking at diagnosis. We need to start looking at pathway. We need to start looking at research and gathering that data. And we need a dedicated healthcare professionals with the experience in long COVID and long COVID treatment, because still to this day, many of our healthcare professionals are still unaware how to diagnose long COVID and how to treat it. So can I just say once again, thank Sandash Gulhani for bringing this to the chamber. Thank the people in the audience up in the gallery there for taking the time out. I know they will pay for that, and hopefully say to the government, it's time we had a plan to deal with this once and for all. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and I call Beatrice Wishart to be followed by Richard Leonard, around 4 minutes. Ms Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Sandesh Gulhani for bringing this important debate to the Chamber this afternoon. And I would like to offer my thoughts to the lives lost and those continuing to live with long COVID. A recent report from Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland highlights that COVID is still shattering lives, with around 180,000 people in Scotland suffering from long COVID. And far be it for me to correct Jackie Bailey, but actually the Liberal Democrats brought the first long COVID debate in this chamber in November 2021. At the time, Alex Cole-Hamilton said, and I quote, "I'm dismayed, however, that we are already 18 or 19 months into the pandemic, and it is at least 12 months since the first sufferers of the condition that we now know as long COVID had that condition identified. It is disappointing, therefore, that it has taken opposition time in a member's business debate to lead for the first time on this important subject in the chamber. The cross-party group on long COVID, of which I am a member, continues to advocate for those living with long COVID and raise the issue repeatedly with the Scottish Government, along with Long COVID Scotland and Long COVID Kids Scotland. Presiding Officer, I'm sure we all know someone who has had their life turned upside down due to getting COVID. Some people are now entering their fifth year of a new phase in their life, and I'm sure all of us have had constituents reach out with the situation they find themselves in, adjusting to their new reality and describing feeling helpless as they try to restore some of their previous well-being. I have previously mentioned a constituent of mine who raised with me the lack of dedicated care for children living with long COVID. The parent told me, and I quote, "Our son is very unwell again, and it's utterly devastating to see. The lack of support for children with long COVID and their families in Scotland is a national disgrace." Long COVID has affected people of all ages, and that has had a profound effect on young people living with long COVID in terms of their development, socialisation and learning, as well as obviously their health. The COVID-19 Recovery Committee's report on long COVID highlighted the lack of research or guidance on the impact of long COVID on children and young people. Another constituent I met recently has had long COVID for 14 months. The life he had before is not the same as the life he has now. He said to give that up, including his job, his home, his sport, and he relies now on support from his family. He has no complaints about the support from his GP, but is surprised at the slow progress that has been made in the treatment and diagnosis pathway here in Scotland. People are spending life savings on seeking support from private clinics, both elsewhere in the UK and in Europe, due to the postcode lottery of treatment and support. Put simply, if you've got long COVID in Scotland, the Scottish Government has allocated around £16 towards your treatment and care in totality. The amount of money spent on the condition in England is nearly 10 times what it is here. To conclude, Presiding Officer, we need to do more to recognise that COVID is still amongst us and do more to stop people and children from catching it in the first place. The Scottish Government needs to adopt a comprehensive and fully funded long COVID strategy to support those living with long COVID. Such a strategy should build awareness among employers so they can recognise it for the disability that it is. We should be getting occupational therapy and social care services to everyone who needs it, particularly those managing the condition from home. And all of this needs to work hand in hand with enhanced psychological support to recognise the impact this has on people's mental health. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call Richard Leonard to be followed by Ben McPherson, around 4 minutes. Mr Leonard.
Presiding Officer, can I thank Sandesh Gulhani for bringing this important motion to Parliament? The shadow of COVID-19 hangs over all of us. It has left its mark.
frontline workers not supplied with the personal protective equipment which there was a legal duty of care to provide. Our most vulnerable citizens, care home residents, placed in unnecessary mortal danger, their basic human rights denied and discarded. Parents of critically ill children, unable to be with them in hospital emergency departments, children unable to say goodbye to dying parents, funerals unmarked. And all of the while, both governments chose not to follow World Health Organization advice, chose not to follow the basic principles of public health and infectious disease control, chose not to test, and the shadow is still with us. As members of this Parliament, we meet some extraordinary people, and I can think of no group who have made a bigger impression on me than the Long COVID Support Group, which meets in Brighton's Village Parish Church Hall. For too long ignored as individuals, they got organised as a collective. Up and against bureaucracy, they adopted the values of self-help, mutual aid and support, but they provide a united voice as well, so that where once they were invisible and silent, they are now highly visible and justifiably vocal. But when I meet them, they tell me that they are still falling through the gaps of what they always believed to be a cradle-to-the-grave system. The first time I met the group, I spoke to a woman with long COVID who still worked night shifts, was now in her 60s, had worked since she left school at 16, who was struggling with both her physical and her mental health, but who simply could not afford to retire. It could make you weep. Misdiagnosis is common. All too often, women are told that they have the menopause, not long COVID. One of my old shop stewards, who is in the group, put it starkly when he said, "If you're thinking about going out, you have to think about getting back." Many, many in the group now have chronic respiratory conditions. And we know that long-term conditions are even less adequately funded than acute care in our public health system. The one ray of light which shone through the shadow of COVID-19 was the rekindling of the principles of solidarity, of sacrifice, of human cooperation. That it did not reach those lawmakers who secretly and criminally organised mass social gatherings, then tried to cover them up, and even now show no contrition, should not surprise us, but it should stir us into action. Because there is a better way. We cannot right all of the wrongs of the past, but we can tackle the injustices of the present. That is not merely a job for government. It is the duty of every single member of this Parliament. But we must all be led by long COVID sufferers and their families, like those I meet in Brighton's. We need to empower them, give them agency, so that our value systems, our institutional forms, our political response is shaped by them, driven by them, and all bound together with the solemn guiding principle that we remember the dead, but that we fight for the living.
Thank you, Mr Leonard. And I call Ben McPherson to be followed by Douglas Lumsden in around 4 minutes. Mr McPherson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I also commend colleagues for bringing this motion to the Chamber. And I'm looking forward to hearing the Government's response to building on the funding and planning that's already been put forward, what more is going to be done to support my constituents with long COVID. But as part of those considerations, I wanted to particularly raise awareness of a group of people in my constituency who've been in touch with me for some time and I've sought to represent with ME. And that is, unfortunately, a growing community in my constituency and internationally, indeed, because of the parallels and synergies between the suffering of those with long COVID and those with ME. So I just wanted to emphasise briefly in this debate that it is important that ME is considered in tandem with how we support people with long COVID, and that it's not forgotten. There are more and more cases internationally of ME since the outbreak of the pandemic. These are areas which require particular attention individually as conditions and have various symptoms within those conditions themselves. But the same debilitating effects are present with those with ME and long COVID. These people need our help, and I'm looking forward to hearing what further actions in terms of research, support and treatment the Scottish Government may be able to provide.
Thank you, Mr McPherson. I now call Douglas Lumsden, to be followed by Fulton McGregor, around 4 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I also thank Sandesh Galhani for bringing this debate tonight. And like Beatrice Wishart, maybe one day we'll have a government-brought debate on this, and that would show that they are taking it seriously. Because while the World Health Organization declared the COVID-19 public health emergency to be over in May 2023, COVID has never gone away. COVID-19 has now moved to its endemic phase. The Scottish Government lifted their measures to deal with the pandemic in August 2021. Yet still, years later, for the estimated 187,000 people in Scotland who are living with long COVID, the pandemic never ended. Long COVID can be life-changing for those who are affected by it. It causes fatigue and breathlessness, among other symptoms. It can completely change the lives of those who before were perfectly healthy. And we've seen that at the drop-in session that we had earlier today. Long COVID can affect anyone, and it can affect them after any exposure they have had of COVID. An estimated 1 in 10 cases of COVID develop into long COVID. Like one of my constituents, Helen Goss, who is having to take legal action against NHS Grampian because of the poor or non-existent long COVID treatment her daughter is receiving. Helen has, well, regrettably forced down the route of legal action as it seemed to be the only viable option to progress and secure the healthcare that her daughter, Anna, urgently requires and rightfully deserves. And as a parent, I can't imagine what Helen is going through. She desperately wants help for her daughter and must feel frustrated at the lack of help she's receiving. You know, what has it come to that parents are having to go to court to get medical assistance? The NHS are letting these people down, and the government are letting these people down. But Helen is not the only one. Today I've been talking to other parents and grandparents who are having to fight to get the treatment they deserve. How can this be right? 10,000 kids are being let down. We can't leave them behind. So, Presiding Officer, to protect people from the detrimental impact of long COVID, prevention is key. And let me draw the Scottish Government attention back to the petition from December 23 by Sally Witcher. The petition called on the Scottish Government to do more to help prevent the spread of COVID and, by the extension, the likelihood of people developing long COVID. And we all know that one of the best ways to prevent the spread of COVID is to increase ventilation. And in NHS England, we're seeing the government encourage the use of HEPA filters in public buildings. NHS England recognises the important role that these filters can play in reducing the transmission of COVID-19. Despite HEPA filters having an efficiency level of over 99%, this is not being replicated in NHS Scotland. The only ventilation method I remember that was proposed by this devolved government was sawing the bottom off of classroom doors. The Scottish Government must ensure a joined-up approach which brings to the forefront mitigating measures like greater ventilation in new buildings and upgrades to ventilation in existing buildings. Long COVID has a debilitating impact on those who have contracted it. The socio-economic impact is obvious. It stops people from working, and this has a long-term effect on local economies, a point that Brian Whittle made earlier. Prevention is key to ensuring that people can avoid contracting long COVID. And as we've heard, this is the third debate we are having on this subject, and it's time that the Scottish Government listen to campaigners and finally act. For those suffering, they can't wait anymore. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Lumsden. And I call the final speaker in the open debate, Fulton McGregor, around 4 minutes. Mr. McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I hadn't originally been down to speak, so I appreciate you being able to bring me in. And I also want to thank Sandesh Gulhani for bringing forward the motion to the Chamber on this extremely important issue.
The Minister will be aware, as well as her predecessor, that I've been raising a case, a constituency case for a while, of a young man, Jonathan McMillan, who was only at high school when he contracted COVID. But as a result of long COVID, his whole life has been turned round, totally changed. For long periods, wasn't able to get out of bed. And his mum, Tracy McMillan, who has been an avid campaigner for Jonathan and by extent long COVID as well, has spoken to me about how that has impacted him, his life and his future. And they've had to fight for absolutely everything. They've had to fight with medical professionals, local authorities and others for just to be heard. For example, recently, Jonathan's actually got POTS, but they've had to fight to get a recognition of that and get appropriate treatment and appointments, a fight which is still ongoing. And Jonathan and his mum, please know that you'll always have my support with that as your MSP. But brick wall after brick wall, and it's because, as other members have said today, it's a lack of understanding out there. What are the symptoms? What aren't the symptoms? What do people know? And I don't think this is the fault of professionals out there. I think there needs to be more done around long COVID so that people in professional know what it is, in the profession know what it is that they're dealing with when somebody presents. And I think that we do need more research in this area. We do need to learn more about it. The Minister also knows, and I know that she won't mind me saying, because I'll come here to stand up for my constituents and issues that they bring to me. The Minister knows, and the Government knows, I've raised it in here, that I do think that folk with long COVID are being left, and I think that we do need to do more. I do think that Scotland's probably not unique in this. We are catching up as we come out of the pandemic, but I think that Bill Kidd made some really important points. Scotland is used to leading the way on things. We were part of the UK, we were leading the way on the vaccine in terms of tackling COVID as an actual disease itself. I think we need to do more to tackle long COVID and lead the way again, get in front of this. I think it's actually a really great suggestion by Bill Kidd. It was his speech that actually prompted me to press my button, actually, because I have spoken, raised the case of Jonathan several times in the chamber. But I do think that there is a possibility there for bringing together a summit in Scotland, Minister, and bringing it together and bringing together experts and actually trying to learn what we know about long COVID, what we don't know, and what could work and what couldn't work, and actually try and link it into ME and other similar diseases as well, as Ben McPherson brought up, because I do think there is some indications that there might be overlap there. So let's lead the way in this. Let's be bold. I would say to other parties, let's not play a blame game about, you know, we're not doing enough, we're not doing X, Y and Z. Let's all work together on this across the chamber and across society, because there's a growing number of people who need it, and every single member here will have had long COVID constituents and will continue to get more. So it's a duty upon all of us, I think, to try and get this right and to back the Minister and how she takes this forward and try and work together. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr McGregor. I now invite Jenny Minto to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to reflect too on those who have lost loved ones through COVID and also those living with long COVID. I would like to thank Sandesh Gulhani for bringing this important debate and everyone for their very considered contributions. I too would like to welcome those in the public gallery. I recognise that for many of you living with long COVID, it won't have been a small undertaking for you to travel here to be with us this evening. I was pleased to spend my lunchtime with members of Long COVID Scotland and others outside the Parliament this afternoon and later on, listening to people's thoughts, concerns, disappointment at the drop-in session. And I would like to thank all of you from my heart for being so candid in sharing the challenges that you live with on a daily basis, and also the constructive provocations that you gave to me to consider. Thank you. The contributions to this evening's debate have clearly highlighted the significant impact that long COVID continues to have on lives of adults and children living with the condition across Scotland. And I will be meeting with Long COVID Scotland and also Long COVID Kids Scotland, including Fulton MacGregor's constituent, later this month. I understand that symptoms vary considerably and can at times be unpredictable and unrelenting. I understand that long COVID can impact every aspect of daily life, not just limited to physical health, and I have been struck by stories of the impact on relationships, education, and also on employment, as we are reminded particularly from the briefing that Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland provided for this debate. International Long COVID Day, marked officially later this week, is an important milestone in bringing these issues into sharp focus. So too was the COVID Recovery Committee's consideration of this subject, and I'd like to thank those that took the opportunity, the MSPs, the stakeholders and those with lived experience who all contributed to that process. And since the publication of the committee's report, progress has been made in a number of key areas, and I'm pleased to have the opportunity to outline some of them. I'd like to touch on the funding. We remain committed to delivering the £10 million long COVID support fund in full. As members may be aware, NHS boards did not require to fully utilise the long COVID support funding made available to them over the first year of the fund, and we've therefore made plans to allocate the remainder of the fund over this coming financial year and the next one. And going forward, we will also consider baselining long COVID support funding for NHS boards at a level to be determined based on progress made by NHS boards over 2023-24.
Jackie Bailey.
My recollection, and please do correct me if I'm wrong, is that the underspend in the first year was allocated very quickly to a range of organisations. So are you stretching the £10 million over 4 years? Because there isn't that spare money in the system, you allocated it.
Minister.
I think it's fair to say that not every board spent its allocation, and we are ensuring that they are, because it takes a while to employ people, has been pointed out in a number of the speeches, but we are committing to spending the £10 million. And also, and to Jackie Bailey's point, it's simply not true that the Scottish Government received any consequentials relating directly to the resource that NHS England allocated for long COVID, as this was not new funding. If I may continue, on public information, we have worked with NHS Inform, Scotland's National Health Information Service, to update the range of long COVID information available on their site. This followed a user research exercise to allow us to better understand the experiences of those living with long COVID, as well as their suggestions on priorities for further development of the content. In terms of education for healthcare professionals, a suite of updated educational resources has been published on NHS Education for Scotland's learning platform, TURIS, to improve healthcare staff's knowledge and understanding of long COVID. And specific to children and young people, the National Strategic Network for Long COVID is currently developing a clinical pathway to support the appropriate assessment, referral and management for children and young people with long COVID symptoms. Once completed, this information will be shared with NHS boards for local implementation. Happy to give
Brian Whittle.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving me. I wonder, in the Long COVID Recovery Committee's investigation, we took evidence from health boards, not just across the UK, but across the world, and their experiences and how they're dealing with the problem of long COVID, because it's not obviously just here. I wonder, if are the Scottish Government still doing that? Are we still pulling data and recommendations from around the world?
Minister, then give you the time.
I thank Brian Whittle for that intervention, and I'll touch a bit on that later on in my response. The debate motion highlighted the importance of clear referral pathways, and I can update that 12 out of 14 NHS boards now have long COVID pathways in operation for adults. And elsewhere, boards have well-established referral pathways to a range of services which can provide support to people with symptoms resulting from long COVID. Earlier this week, I was very pleased to visit NHS Ayrshire and Arran. And Mr Whittle, I think it might be worthwhile you visiting the service there. If you already have. great. So I met the team responsible for the planning and delivery of the board's multidisciplinary long COVID pathway and hear how they're utilising funding made available through the Scottish Government's £10 million long COVID support fund. The pathway provides a single point of access for assessment and coordinated support to help people manage their long COVID symptoms. The service has physiotherapy, occupational therapy and nursing support and liaises with primary and secondary care and third sector partners. Clearly, the multidisciplinary team that a number of members have been noting as being important. And I certainly felt, having spoken to the team, their commitment to continuous improvement and learning was very, very obvious. And whether that was through undertaking additional training, through learning from and sharing the unique skills and expertise that each member brought to the multidisciplinary team, or learning from the experience of peers in other NHS boards and elsewhere. But also, importantly, as a number of people have made in their contributions, listening to the patients. In that respect, our National Strategic Network for Long COVID is important in giving our territorial NHS boards a forum for sharing learning and best practice from within and beyond Scotland in developing support and services for people living with the condition, as Mr Whittle suggested. I was also privileged to meet someone who told me about their experience of developing long COVID and the impact it continued to have on their daily life. Hearteningly, they spoke about how the expertise and support provided to them through the long COVID pathway was a significant milestone in their journey with long COVID. I think the points that Ben McPherson made struck me as well when I was speaking to this patient, and the connections that she drew as well with ME and the debilitating effects that that condition has. Scotland is doing some research in the Western in Edinburgh, which I have visited, and I think that's something for me to maintain in my thought, is the connection between ME and the possible connection between ME and long COVID. But also what struck me were the reflections on the care and compassion of the multidisciplinary team and the value that they placed on to be listened to and validated by the healthcare professionals. And I think this also resonates with what a lot of people have said this evening. I want to be clear that I recognise, absolutely recognise, that there is more to do to ensure that people's experiences of accessing healthcare support are consistent. We remain committed to working closely with our National Strategic Network, which has commissioned the University of Leeds to support the initial evaluation of long COVID services in Scotland. I also appreciate that the limitations of the treatment approaches we currently have available globally for long COVID will be a source of frustration for those living with the condition. We need to ensure that treatments are evidence-based. There is still a great deal to be learned regarding long COVID, which is why we are contributing to the worldwide research effort to better understand the condition. Our Chief Scientist Office has awarded a total of around £3.1 million for 11 projects on the long-term effects of COVID-19. This includes projects to better understand the underlying risk factors of long COVID, to examine effects on cognitive function, to evaluate rehabilitation approaches, and to examine access and explore how to improve people's support through primary care. I would like to use this opportunity to highlight that the Chief Scientist's Office research funding schemes are open to applications on long COVID, and these would go through CSO standard independent expert review processes to allow funding decisions to be made. And I note the proposal that Fulton McGregor made with regards to a summit, and I'm happy to take that away and speak to my officials with regards to that. In closing, I would like to again acknowledge the significant impact that long COVID can have on the lives of people who directly experience it, as well as those closest to them, and reiterate that supporting people living with long COVID remains a priority for this government.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.